iPad is that I'm not stuck, you know? So like, if I've got somebody who isn't paying, you know, close attention,
yeah,
I don't have to say anything. I can just kind of teach from here like I was planning on anyway. And so anything that gets you that proximity to your students is helpful.
Yeah. And more on a more positive side, when you see the student answers, it's nice because you have that kid who you expect to say something like llamas.
Right.
And they actually provide the right answer, but they never would have raised their hand in class because
exactly.
they don't have the confidence. And then you can, you know, call them out and share, hey, your answer was correct. And
mm-hmm.
it gives them more confidence.
Right.
Yeah, I think it is. And just, you know, like being able to kind of parlay their, you know, like the person who's got those answers that are close every time, you'd be like, okay, let's talk about why this is close, you know, and then what could we change on this answer to make it correct, you know, and so there's a lot of, you have access to their brain a lot more
right.
with this list of answers.
So do we need to download an app?
Yeah, there's a Nearpod app.
And so you're saying Candace has a license for it, so it'll be
mm-hmm.
free to me, but like she does.
All things are free.
So Nearpod is free. There's just some premium features that you can pay for.
Okay. And
so what we've done so far, you can do in any.
And then the kids would just Google Nearpod. It would be.
They can go to Nearpod.com, but on our iPad, when we have carts, the EdTechs can put Nearpod on all of the iPads. So they just log in with the session just like you did. Okay. So, sorry.
And the other thing is, like, with my ELLs, I mean, they couldn't write a full sentence to say, you know, and have it be proper, you know, whatever. And so it was nice that I could see that, and I knew exactly what they were trying to say. So sometimes I wouldn't share it, but I would say it out loud. And then they would still know, you know, because I didn't want to embarrass them about their spelling or, you know, whatever. And so I was able to just say it out loud and get their shared answer out there, too.
That's great. And, you know, you don't have to say who said it if they're
exactly
about that.
Yeah, sometimes I would just scroll down and say the answers and then move on. So
yep, it gives you like that freedom to kind of make those judgments as you want to.
Mm-hmm.
So the other thing is that it also helps with those stakeholders, and I know that we've got, you know, parents that want to know what's happening in our classrooms. They want to know, what is my student learning? Because, you know, children are terrible messengers. So, you know, when they're talking to their kids in the car or at dinner or whatever, what'd you learn in school today? Nothing. And we know that they didn't learn nothing. You know, they learned some things. They just, you know, don't know how to just articulate that to their parents. This way, if you have, you know, communication with your parents through a website or a Canvas page or Google Classroom or one of those great tools, you can put the lesson directly on there and they can see exactly what you learned about. And you're giving the parents talking points for the kids to like kind of prompt some more of that thinking that they learned in class today. Okay, so this is my question for you, because blended learning does bring everyone in. What is the most important thing your parents or guardians can do to support the students to be successful in your classroom? And I know we're talking about a dream world and these are not things you can control, but what if you could control it, what would be the thing that they could do? And what you'll find is that, you know, once you've done a couple of Nearpods with your class, you're not teaching the tool anymore. Like, they catch on really quick. And I had a first grade teacher a couple years ago who, she said, well, my kids are too young. They can't do this. They can't log in. They, you know, we all know those guys who we work with sometimes. And I went in there and did a Nearpod, and the kids signed in no problem. That was the easiest part, was they just got it and they participated in the activities. And she was just completely like, I didn't know they could do this. And I was like, I know, you need to believe they can do this, first of all. But also that, like, you know, these tools are built for kids in school. This is what, you know, and so.
Well, look how many moms, when their kid's kind of fussy as a 2-year-old, they just hand them their phone.
Right.
You know, or whatever. I mean, kids have the device.
And what you notice,
yeah.
too, is that they're kind of like, especially with iPads, you know, toddlers are able to go between apps and find a game, and we're just like, wow. But it's like, it's because it's built for humans, and this is the natural way that humans would do something. So they're at the Hogle Zoo. They have orangutans who, in the winter months when they can't go outside, they put iPads up to the cage, and the orangutans play with the iPads. They figured out that their fingernails were too long. So the apes turned their hand over to swipe on the iPad. They just figured that out. And they like the drum games, and they like drawing on there. And it's just really funny. It's like, okay, so primates, people, these devices are kind of naturally made for us. So when we see babies able to do this, like, it's like, well, we don't need to teach that. It's they'll figure it out. So I want to talk about some of these answers, because these are really, really good. So encouraging the students to get on Canvas at night to log in and see what's going on in the students' classes. Now this puts a responsibility on us to make sure those pages are up to date and useful. So, you know, like if they go to it too many times and you see that there's not up to date material, then they're not going to use that as a resource. And so it's important for us to make sure that we are continually updating and making sure we're prepared ourselves. But that is so good. And like just like this one here, reading their email, just to being aware and involved. I believe, in my experience with parents, that they all want to be involved. They all want to support. They all want their children to be successful. The difference is that some of them have more means of doing that. And so as we see more and more working parents who really want to be involved, but what would keep them from being involved as much as they'd like to? What do you think? Time?
What else?
Understanding the tech.
Understanding what, yeah, so like if they don't know what you're teaching, and they're already pressed for time because they've got so many jobs and different roles they have to play, and you know, we've got people who are surviving, you know, and just if those needs are continually being needed to address, then we need to make it easy for them to know what it is, what we're doing in class, and make it easy for them to access it. And so having a user-friendly tool and an easy, where they just have to click a link and don't have to create an account and just see what we're learning in class, gives them the ability to support.
We have to learn as teachers to be concise too. We're not gonna read long, wordy things.
That's right, and you know, you just wanna make it as easy as possible and know that we can't use lack of support as an excuse for anything because we can't control it. And so, but our chances of getting more of that are increased if we, you know, make it easy. We minimize the steps and make sure what we're doing in class. And you know, these children spend all day in school. And so we know that like if we make it complicated for them to be able to access the materials, then you know, it's gonna be difficult for them to make that a priority. And you can see here that the mom helped them study. You know, and so just having that memory of knowing that there's someone there to help you, you know, work through what you've learned in class is so good. Does anybody else have any thoughts about what we're talking about with parent involvement? Okay. I see your thoughts here, they're really good. All right, and then let's do this one here. Another thing that blended learning can do is make children accountable. You know, because so far in the traditional world, they're accountable for having their butt in the seat, right? They're accountable for being there. And beyond that, we just can't know what they're listening to and what they're hearing. Except now we can, because they're expected to respond and demonstrate their knowledge. And so that's a great thing technology has done for us, is enabling them to be able to do that.
Can I say something? Yeah. Because a lot of us here are secondary, and I think parent involvement kind of drops off.
Sure.
Organization would be great. And I was just thinking, we're doing like a little, like a freshman orientation. I thought we need to have a parent session as part of that. That we can say, look, here's how you do these things. Because I think they just don't know.
Yeah.
They're unaware.
Yeah, and I think if you could make it easy for them to know, you know, they would love that.
And heck, we could do a screencast and email it to them, and then they could watch it, right?
Totally. Totally good. Or an Nearpod presentation.
Or a Nearpod presentation so they know how it works.
Exactly. And so, yeah, just walking them through, you know, exactly here's how you access this. And, you know, just making it easy. I know that whenever I make, like, a how-to step-by-step for teachers, you know, it's, you got to just make sure everything's there, that it's easy to be able to follow. Okay, so. Real quick question, what's the most common way you communicate with parents? We got a lot of emails, okay? Which is really good. my I don't know, fourth or fifth year of teaching, and I had a class with pretty involved parents. These parents really wanted to know, and I would call parent-teacher conferences like the audit, because they would come in and be like, okay, well, tell us what's happening, how seriously are you taking this, you know. So I had weekly emails, and the year I started doing that, the audit was much easier because they just wanted to be informed. So like when they came in, you know, we basically just talked about what was going on in class. It was very positive. They trusted me more, and it was just like, email is so easy, and they just want to be able to read it. Even if they don't respond, like just feeling like they know what's happening at school makes them feel better. So it's really good. All right. Now back to the blended flipped learning idea. Wouldn't you love to have more engagement and less time just explaining? Like more time with them building and making. And so what you can do is whenever you apply blended learning, you give the students responsibility and application. They can use the time in class to apply the learning. And because they went through a Nearpod last night and answered these questions, and you know, you briefly go over the answers to the questions if you want to at the beginning of class. Spend the first 10 minutes explaining, spend the next 40 minutes, you know, building based on what you've done. So, what dream project would you do if you had more quality time with students? Think of the thing that you have not been able to do but have been thinking about for years or months, and if you had all of the quality time, no restrictions, what would you do? All right, so I see a lot more like hands-on type deal. This is good. All right, I'm just gonna cut you off. That's the other thing. If you share an answer, it cuts off the people from being able to answer if they have it. But so the genius hour, who's heard of this before? And who's thought, wouldn't that be nice? But I have 50 minutes and so like it's one of those things where if you can give them the skills they need, they can then channel that into something that they want to do, you know, and be able to create something cool. And it's awesome to just see students engaged. And I see like, okay, foods. They can research the foods and they can explain why one's better than others. Really good. Okay. I like this answer. But be thinking about this while you are building and you don't know yet. You can be thinking about, okay, this is how I can make my curriculum work to where I can have more application time. And then also being able to find out what interests them the most, what they really want to learn. And you know, they don't care what you know unless they know that you care. You know, so I think that's close. Right? So just like, how many of those teachers that you know that you remember really wanted to know what you cared about and really help that learning to be really applicable to your interests? I like this would be truly student imagined. That's a really cool way of saying that. All right, and differentiation is now possible because they can move at their own pace and kind of take ownership of their own learning. So this is an example of what a report looks like. And you can kind of scroll. This is a PDF that you can scroll in your body here. I blurred out the names, but you can see kind of each question has answers. And this looks like one slide, but you really can just scroll because it's a PDF. And so all of the draws are toward the, you'll see little thumbnails of their drawings for the fractions question. And this is nice too because you can get reports for individuals or for the whole class. And if you've got that student or you've got a parent who's concerned or you're concerned about how they're engaging in class, you can print an individual report of, this is actually today's lesson. So look how she answered these questions. And this is what I'm talking about. You know, so if you need to found what you're sharing with parents or show them something incredible to demonstrate progress. So this is what a report would look like. This was a lesson for fourth grade math.
I have a quick question for you. At the top when it has the student participation, is that just who logged in or?
So when it talks about students, it's kind of it's the activities they participated in. So sometimes you might skip activities in the live lesson because, you know, we've got it. So that'll affect the student participation. Okay. But really, like, if there's, you know, and so you do kind of have to look at the report to see specific answers. Yeah.
What are the frowny faces for?
So the frowny faces mean that they didn't finish everything. So I think that they're working on that, but that means they didn't see every slide. On the homework, on the student-led one, it should be smiley, which means they viewed everything and participated in everything. So, Drea, did you use the reports very much for your grades?
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about
that? Oh, for my grades. I don't know. I mean,
or
so I would implement these a lot in my independent work time. In, you know, in elementary, we have an hour of that. So I would give those out, and just to make sure, I would just do like random checks from my computer on my reports, just to see where they were at, just to see how they were answering. And that kind of allowed me to be doing what I needed to do with my small group, but still making sure everyone was doing what they were supposed to be doing. And, you know, I would call out those kids that, you know, maybe weren't answering correctly, or I could see that they just like rushed through the slide, you know. And I didn't use it more as like the grading assessment
just
tool.
Accountability.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I used it a lot for assessment in my house last year, especially when it came to C-test evidences. Mm-hmm. Having that report, I could take a screenshot and say, this is how I'm showing this.
And you blew your administrator's mind.
Yeah. And you're like, whoa.
Well, it was easy. Do that.
You
know.
No, that's great though, because I mean, the more information we have about our students, the more we can drive our instruction to, you know, adhere to what they need. And so it's like, this is kind of taking more of that guesswork out of what do they need, what are they struggling with, you know, we can see exactly what's happening. Yeah.
So when you're using this as student-led, say they're doing something at home, and you're using it for all of, say, your sixth grade classes, every time they sign in and complete the slides, all your sixth graders are going to be like.
So every pin is together. So one report is tied to one pin. So when we're talking about stations here, so if Drea has only 5 Chromebooks in her classroom, the next group comes and signs in with a new pin. She's going to have different reports for each group because they're in a different pin.
So for each period, you could reassign it to that class period, and it would assign it a new pin. It would still be the same presentation.
Yeah.
But if you reassigned it to that period, it would give it a whole new pin and a whole new report for just that group of kids.
So if you're doing an at-home student-led activity, could your instructions be period 1B signing with this pin? Can you set it up that way?
Yeah, you can. You just tell them which pin goes with their period. If you're in a Canvas course,
right,
and you have different sections, you just would launch the 6 times or whatever for each. So you'd have 6 different copies of that Nearpod.
At some point in the day, you'd have to tell each period their own pin.
Yeah.
So that they could log in that night and get their own individual, like, so second period has their own presentation. And then maybe in third period at the end, like, you erase on the board and you have third period's pin, and they can log in that way. Erase it, go to fourth period, here's their pin. You know what I mean? And then that night when they log in, they can just use that specific pin to get in.
And you could put it in each individual section in your Canvas course, you know, just have a different LT. Because I'll show you the LTI in a minute, which is just automatically embeds it in there. And so you would just put it in each section.
Does this list them alphabetically?
However they signed in. So you may have to do a little bit of teaching about how they need to sign in. And I know that Nearpod's working with Canvas to have a single sign-on so that their Canvas login is the same as their Nearpod login so that they don't have to type a name. But that development is not complete yet. So.
But I'm saying if you had them sign in, say, their period and then their day and then their name, would the report list them in that order because they signed in to be...
So there would be, they wouldn't need to put their period if that, because that group
just
is just
their
that
own
group
theme.
Of kids.
Right. I'm just saying if it was like the whole...
There's
2 lines. You notice when you sign in, you could have them put their name here, and then the second line would be,
their
period 2,
mm-hmm.
if you wanted to do that.
Yeah, I was just wondering how the report listed it. So if I want them separated by periods, I don't know what to put first, but I can just figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you can, I would break up the precinct. I would have a separate pin for each period just to make your brain not explode when you see this. But yeah, if you've got them all together, you can teach them a different way to sign in. But that's how the reports are going. Yeah.
Does the free Nearpod still restrict how many people can sign in
yes.
for session?
Yes. So like you can have 30 people on the free one. For the district license, it's up to 100, I think. And if you have more, like if you have a big assembly going on, you can call them and they'll open up more. Yeah.
So, but that's the reason why you would need to separate it into periods.
Yeah. And the Nearpod home, the student led is not available for free.
Oh,
so, yeah. So
okay.
That's the other thing. All right. So we're gonna play with the quiz feature.
Wait, what did you just say about student fees?
It's not free. It's a premium feature.
Oh, anymore? So Canyon's
it's never
people.
Been free.
Canyon's people can get it.
Okay. I was like.
Because they have a district license.
Right.
But.
Okay. Yeah. So Canyon's. I was like.
All right, so here's my question, and it's okay because this is a pretest. If you've never heard of this, you can just guess. What does the S in SAMR represent? That's okay. So on your screen, I send the pie chart here. So if you're asking a quiz question, if you do one question at a time, it will send basically the pie chart to the whole class and how we did, and then if you look under my answers, they can see if they got it right or wrong. So talk about student engagement. It's a really easy way to do a quick check for understanding, and we'll see how we did. And my favorite thing that happens is when you're in a class and they see the pie chart, and that's the whole class, they say, oh, we did better. Like, and I love that, it makes my heart sing. Like, oh, we did better, we got, you know. And so in terms of it's like, okay, let's see if we can do this class. It doesn't share who got what, but it does show our overall. And this is for when you do a quiz, just one question. If you do multiple questions, it's a little different. We'll show you that later.
Now, can you change the colors, or is that just a given?
Well,
green,
it's
then.
Green is correct,
yeah,
and red is not. But
yeah,
I would never project this to a group of students. You know, this is just what my screen looks like. So, okay. Out of there. And all right, so we're going to talk about the SAMR model real quick. Jared's here. He actually taught me about the SAMR model many years ago.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Did I do a good job?
You did. Well, you'll see if I understand or not. So basically, you know, we talk about depth of knowledge questions. You know, the levels of how deep are we teaching. SAMR. Has to do with technology integration. How deep are you using technology? The first level is substitution, and the second level, augmentation, third, modification, fourth, redefinition. And we're going to go through each of these really quickly. So first level, substitution. I'm not putting value attached to these, so if you're feeling like, okay, generally that's where I am, that's okay. You've got to start somewhere. So basically, tech acts as substitution, no functional change. So instead of giving the students a worksheet, I put it in a PDF and they annotate on it and turn it in that way. Has the technology really changed what they're doing in that instance? No. And so it's not terrible. Sometimes you just, you know, you want to have a paperless classroom and that's great. But, you know, that's not the highest level that you could do if you're not getting everything you can. So the next level would be augmentation, that tech is a substitute with some functional improvement. This would be like Google Docs, you know, like, so you're able to, the word processor can spell check and do some things that you couldn't do without the technology, using Google Docs on that level, just a word process. You know, functional improvement. Modification, tech has led to significant task redesign. So this would be like using Google Docs to collaborate. Students are writing together on Google Docs. They're sharing with each other. Something that wasn't easy. They could do it on a piece of paper, but that would be awkward. Like this way they have an actual project that they're collaborating on. And then finally, redefinition. Tech has led to tasks that are impossible without it. And so ultimately, we'd hope that we could bring in more of these things to get the most out of our technology. Our districts are investing so much in devices and teacher training and what you're probably finding is that nobody's got it all figured out. So getting to the highest level of redefinition means that we've got some pressure on us to innovate our practices to be able to really take advantage of that. So let's experience a redefinition example. We're going to travel the world with Nearpod virtual reality capability. Okay, so we're going to go to the Arc de Triomphe. If you're on an iPad, you can move it up and down and it will show you the... Yeah. If you're on a computer, you can just use your mouse to kind of hold and scroll. But think about if you could take them to a place to see, you know. And, you know, they're using Cities 360, which people submit their own, like, 360 photos. And so the more popular the landmark, the more vantage points and times of day that you'll have of that. But you can take them anywhere that, you know, anyone's taken a picture of. And I'll show you how to search for that. So I'm going to let you play for just a second while I get this up here.
Does anybody want to hold the iPad?
So if I wanted to add a new place with my presentation, I'm just going to show you what that looks like here. I guess I should have shown you that. So I can do it in this create button, or I can do it in my library. I'm going to choose my library. And there are folders now, which is super cool. But I click here, new, and then I choose lesson. And then I click add slide. Add content. And then this is where I get the field trips here. So what I do is they'll give you some of their, you know, most popular ones here on this front page. You can even take the students to Mars. Couldn't do that without technology before. So think of a place. What's a good place?
Salt Lake City.
I was helping a kindergarten teacher, and she's like, that's amazing. Do you think we could take them to, like, Sandy City Hall? So I'm just like, we could, you know, like...
Go the arch, go Delicate Arch.
Let's see. Delicate Arch.
I used to take my kids for prize down there on the field trip. That was fun.
All right, so let's do this one. And so you saw there are other, if you want to preview it, you just double click it here. And got it. But it'll let you go full screen. It'll let you see kind of what you're going to do, and you say, okay, that's a good, because, you know, some of these are better than others, and so you can say, all right, that'll work. But any place that you can think of has, you know, probably one of these things here. So we could go more than 4 hours away if we wanted to, you know, and so we could go to Mars or the moon or any other place that we've sent rovers to.
You go to the South Pole.
Let's go to the South Pole. I like that. Okay, South Pole. Even if I don't know a specific place in the South Pole.
It's Antarctica.
Yeah, so I'll just put Antarctica, we'll just do that. All right, so this is a place. And so you can preview it here. That's Antarctica. It'd be hard to get approval for a field trip to Antarctica.
This is also a premium feature.
Yes. So if, talk to me after and we can see what we can, they'll give you like 30 days, but I can talk to them and see if they can give you guys some time to play. All right. So that is the field trip feature, but you can add those. And so think about any kind, and kids just love it. It's really kind of funny to watch them learn about that, but sorry, keep some things really quick. All right, so back to our quiz here. This is a several questions quiz. What you're going to see is you can move from question to question at your own pace. And so when you're creating these, you want to make the judgment of, do I want to talk about each individual question or do I want to let them answer 5 or 6 questions on their own? So go ahead and answer these questions as best you can remember.
So, Drea, when you had kids that finished the quiz first, then did they just go to another site and just wait for you doing something else, or did you?
Yeah, and I mean, generally they're all pretty much finished within a minute or so of each other, so they just had to wait.
Okay.
You know, but yeah, I mean, my kids got pretty savvy with like their tabs and numicos and all that good stuff. So.
And I can see here on mine, I can see how we're, you know, like something happened. It's hard to see because, can you see this? It's green. So I can see their letters here, and I can kind of see how fast we're moving along. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty easy to know when it's cool to, so I'm going to get out.
You know, and just those regular teacher moments of like, hey, you've got 1 more minute, yep. You got to go faster, you know, or whatever.
And sometimes, you know, just saving that for the end so that they can just turn it in or whatever. But they love seeing how they did. So the fact that I can send, the pie chart you're looking at now is just your score. And then if they click my answers, they can see what the correct answers were on yours.
Well, we were supposed to do that. I was doing something.
It's okay. So you can see. They could do it on their phone. This is what they call a device agnostic program. It just does a
draw.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. So there's an Android app. There is an iOS app that works with Apple iPhone and iPad, and on any internet browser.
So do they then use the finger on their screen,
mm-hmm.
just like that?
Yep.
With the virtual reality, if you created your own photosphere, could you get that into your?
So you have to get it into Cities 360, and then, which I think is free to do, and then it would be searchable. Should be on.
I just have a hard time with students that have a lab in a different room, but I can't take them toward the other room because there's
lots
in that room at that time.
Yeah, so that's it's going through the Cities 360 account. And so if it's there, you should be able to find it. You know, if you've uploaded something. Then you just create an account. But that's a really cool idea to use with that. All right, so that's the quiz. You can see how the correct answers show up, so that immediate feedback is so helpful too.
So like I screwed up, is there a way for you and the controller to fix that? Like,
so if I unshare it, then you could go back in and take it. Yes?
One thing I like to do is have the same questions twice in a row. And then, so we could talk about the ones kids got wrong. And then I would say, okay, now let's go for 100% mastery this time.
Give me a chance to take it.
Just
so I think, and if you have a kid who turned in an activity on accident, did like a draw it, and they can click exit and then get back in the session and it will show their drawing again so they can go back and fix it if they want to. So if you've got somebody who's crying because they didn't turn it in, that way. Okay, so this is my question for you. What level, and this is a poll. A poll is different than a quiz because no values attached to it. Just kind of, if you're asking a question, you just want to get an idea of the room. That's what a poll can do. So what level do you feel you use the most often with your teachers and students? Or with your students or teachers, depending on who you're dealing with. This is good. Okay, I'm going to share this now. About half are at the augmentation level, which is not bad at all. That's pretty good. Which means that you're using your technology pretty regular, which is awesome. So when districts ask to have, you know, funds rationalized, why are we using this for this? You know, we need to be able to explain why it made something we're doing better. Like the guy who wrote the article about no laptops in class doesn't see the value in having those in class, doesn't know how to use them. With the students in a way that's productive. One of our responsibilities that we have as teachers today is to teach the students how to use devices in productive ways. So you know that you don't have to teach them how to Facebook or Snapchat. They know how to do that. They know how to use the devices to mess around, but they don't know how to use them to be productive, how to use Google tools to be able to create something, you know, that would make them college career ready. So that's why I believe we can't just ban devices from classes because that means we're not teaching something, and something fills the vacuum. You know, they're gonna. And I've heard that the digital landscape described as the Wild West because it's developed so quickly there hasn't been an etiquette. You know, like when someone calls, may I ask who's calling? You know, we've learned how to politely answer the phone. But texting and messaging and using technology to communicate and interface with each other, that etiquette hasn't been developed in a way that has helped our students to become good digital citizens. That has to be explicitly taught. And so part of those experiences come through using the devices for productivity in class. Okay. All right, so building, I'm just gonna go through this real quick. Make sure, we've all been to in-services where these rules have been broken. How many of you have seen a PowerPoint where there were a billion words on the slide and the presenter just read them? Okay, you don't want to be that guy, so just keep it very simple. I'm going to go through this very quickly. I use Haiku Deck to create my slides because it's easy and beautiful, and it doesn't take a lot of effort for me to make beautiful slides. I recommend it to all of you. Haiku Deck does have a cost to export their slides as PowerPoints, and it's $60 a year, but there's a discount that you can get, and I have a coupon code I'll show you in a second.
And it sounds like a lot, but if you use Nearpod, I mean, I use Haiku Deck every time, and so when it popped up that we had to pay, it wasn't even a question if I wanted to pay that $60 or not. Because for me, having those slides be exactly how I wanted them to be and like have that bright color and the right font, it was perfect. So, yeah.
So this is actually, I'm sending you a website. This is an example of what a Haiku Deck would look like. If you're in a browser and it didn't just open a window, you just click the blue button and it'll take you to the website. What's cool about sharing a website through Nearpod is that you can kick everybody out of the website and move on to the next slide. So what you're looking at right now is a Haiku Deck that I made. But this is, I make these slides and then it gives you an export feature and that's what you're paying for. So I just took you out of that and took you to a different website and this shows you the pricing. But write this down. If you choose the EDU subscription, you can enter this code and it will give you 25% off your $60. So that's a coupon code there. And I asked Haiku Deck if I could keep using this coupon code, and they said that's fine, go ahead and share it. So when you go to the EDU subscription, know that it'll say, this is for teachers, so you have to have a .edu account. And I said, well, our district has a .org account, and he said, actually, it doesn't know. Like, so we just put that because we want only teachers to apply, so just know that, like, it'll say you have to have a .edu, but you don't actually. So,
I have a question.
Yes.
On the slide on the right, there's that little drop-down arrow, and it mm-hmm. has my name and notes and exit.
Yes, so you can take notes. It will go. You can export those to a Google Doc, so the kids could take notes during the presentation, and then it will just go to, which is a cool feature that is developed recently.
So,
yes.
Haiku Deck is free. So, what is the coupon actually giving you?
So, the ability to export.
Export. So, export and download files. Well,
yeah,
when you make your presentation, you want to export it to your Nearpod as a PowerPoint or a PDF or whatever.
So here's a little video that shows you what that would look like. So watch your screen. And so this is also how I create little screencasts and put them in the Nearpod if I have to show them. So you just drag the PowerPoint over and it goes right in and then you have your slides just all in there.
What do you do if your PowerPoint's more than 10 megabytes?
So yeah. That's when I would save as pictures and just drag them in to, you should have like 30 or 40 megabytes to use, or export it as like a smaller PDF, because the PDF will still come in as individual slides as well. So all your little transitions, you know, you
yeah.
need to flatten those guys out. But
yeah, I'm assuming no animation.
No, and they talked about why, because they were like, the thing is we had to pick what we were going to focus on. And so the animations would take much more bandwidth and make the tool less reliable. So they said, you know, so we decided no animations. The way I got around that was I'd have a separate slide for, you know, if I were adding bullet on my presentation, I'd have a slide with the first bullet, a slide with the first two bullets, a slide with the first three bullets.
So is there a way, if you've already spent hours and hours and hours on PowerPoint animations and stuff, is there a way to jump back and forth from Nearpod to a PowerPoint?
You can just, you can toggle if you wanted to have it up here and have certain parts of it. Like Jared did yesterday where he had part of his presentation was in PowerPoint, then, you know, he put the interactive activities in Nearpod. And so you just know where you're going to pause and have a quiz or a question.
So how did you link?
No, they weren't linked. I just had my iPad sitting there and my, it's Google Slides for PowerPoint works too, but you just click next to your slides. And I didn't put every single image. That would have been easier because then I could have clicked next and swiped at the same time and then they're all on the same page. But I only grabbed a handful of them, the most important ones, and put them in the Nearpod. But the other teachers that I've seen do the same thing. We talked about this one teacher at Brighton High School who would have a PowerPoint and lessons and things going on, but then there were other interactive activities in Nearpod. So it was like a classroom simulation. They were having like Model UN kind of thing. So they would have, the PowerPoint would be going, students would be presenting, and then because it's like Model UN, somebody got news that, you know, some country had been bombed. And so then on the Nearpod, they just had, they never went in order on the slides. They just pop up the menu at the bottom. And so they would just pick a jet or a bomb video, and all of a sudden on everybody's Nearpod, you know, they're watching the class lecture and everything's happening, but in the Nearpod, they all of a sudden see this city get bombed. They have a poll that pops up, you know, such and such city was attacked. Will you join forces with the city, or will you join forces with the attackers? So it was a completely separate activity, but there was interaction going on in Nearpod because you can control that, and then the lesson, traditional lesson going on face-to-face. It was really cool to watch.
But that being able to kind of choose your own adventure on the slide, yeah, pacing, you know, like this is, because that's what you're doing. You're just sending things to the people.
So you're looking like from the bottom, you're trading
out
there.
So if I wanted to do this slide, this sends everything out. So what Jared's talking, what Jared's talking about is, okay, if I've got my bomb graphic that I'm going to send to everyone, I just scroll over to that and then just drag it up there. In addition to this, what you can do live is if you go up here and touch this little arrow here, there's on the fly features. So if I find that I want to ask a question, you know, like, I thought they would get it by now, but they didn't. And so I need to ask an additional question. I can add a draw it, or I can even make a new slide real quick and send that out, or have an open-ended question, or send them to a specific website if I want to do that. So I'll just start with the slide here, and I can actually go, okay, so this is me. You can't see this on your screen. You can see up on the top here, and I'm going to highlight it. And I'm going to take a little picture here. I can take a picture of you guys, and then I'm going to use that photo. So think about this, if I had a student's work, I could just take a picture of it, and then I share that with all of you. I now have a slide that I made just now. You know, and so if I want to take a picture of something the kids have done and share that out, I can do that. I can also, this is kind of cool too, if I wanted to add an image from the camera roll or take a live picture and have everybody draw on it, then now I've created, okay, circle what you think, you know, and this is a draw it activity now that I've just sent out on the fly. So that's kind of cool. Those are the on-the-fly features, and those are found on the, if you're using a computer, it's still the same thing at the very top there. You just click that, you could be able to, when you're doing a presentation. Okay, so real quick, saving as pictures, like what Jared was talking about, if your PowerPoint is too big, you can, this is older PowerPoint, you can do the same thing with the new PowerPoint, you can just choose export and change it to a JPEG. But what it'll do is it'll save it, and I've turned me off here. It'll save it in a folder with all your slides, so you can just drag them over in chunks.
That's what I did. I ended up doing. I exported my PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Those pictures, grabbed the slides, and dropped them in.
Instead of using PowerPoint, if you're in Google Classroom, these are slides.
So slides, there is a Google extension that you can get in Chrome called Nearpodize This. So. And if you just click that button, it'll automatically send all your Google Slides to a Nearpod presentation. So I've used that before. You can also export your Google Slides as a PowerPoint if you're having trouble and you just want to drag the file over that way too. All of the activities that are interactive are in Add Activity, and I can add, what I like to do is, one reason to save as pictures is that you can actually drag the picture of the slide to the question. So when the students click it, and you're going to see this question in just a second, the question gets larger. So if you wanted to use like a piece of text or something to have a reference for the question, you can put that in there. And so if you look at this question here, pretend like there's a question, but if you click a little picture, so click a little picture there, and then
this is the 7-4.
Yep. And it will get larger. So if they needed a reference picture or a question, you can just drag those into each question. You click again and it goes back to being small and they can answer the question. So with math and things like that, it's really handy to have a little graphic there. Okay. So two ways to launch. We got a live session. That's what we're doing right now. This is what it looks like. So I'm just gonna let you watch this little video here. Go to My Library, then you hover over your presentation and you choose live session, and then you start, you share that pin, and you write that on the board. And again, every report is tied to the pin. So there you go, it's showing you how you can move around. So we're going to scooch ahead, and we talked about on the fly already, and I have a video for that, but I'm just going to give you guys access to this later so you don't have to watch it at all. But the new way that they're sharing the student pace, this is what you're looking at now, is that instead of live session, you choose student pace. Now, if you look at all these options, the envelope, the share button, the link, the embed code, Google Classroom, if you click Google Classroom, it'll go straight to Google Classroom, and it will ask you to choose if you want this to be an announcement or an assignment. It's very cool. It's very easy. And then, but that's the student-led asynchronous version of that. Did you use it with Google Classroom very much?
Yeah, I did. And some days I would just put the code up on the board. Like, a lot of times I would just have, like, this is what you need to do today, and I'd have it, like, written in a Word document and have the code up there. Or I would put it in their Google Classroom, and I would just say, okay, everything you need to know is on Google Classroom today. But sometimes, I mean, I'm not going to lie, I was not a very prepared teacher sometimes. So I would just, like, do it on the quickness and just write it up and have it up there. So either way.
I was going to ask them, how long did it take you to make these?
I mean, you get faster and faster, but honestly, and it depends on how in depth you go. You know, you could I could probably make one in a half hour, really, like if I was to make it really, you know, it just depends on the time. Like with Reading Street, I would do my whole unit for the week in an Nearpod, and it took me about an hour.
So. It takes about as long as it takes to plan a lesson.
Yeah.
So like if you're making a PowerPoint presentation or something like that's what takes the most time. Yeah. And so it's like if you already have the slides made, like you've already made dozens of lessons that you use all the time, then you know, the difference is you're just adding little interactive activities that you maybe would have done audibly before, but now you can just add in. So when we had a workshop here. We did it at Mount Jordan. We're doing it again this year, called Building Nearpod into Your Classroom. And it was 7 weeks, and it was 2 hours each class. It was worth a credit of USOE or SU credit. And we spent the first hour, I'd teach them something more in depth, because we're kind of doing an overview here. But they, part of the goal I had for the class was that people would kind of get that rhythm that Drea is talking about, like be able to kind of, and I had a few teachers in there. I had one I was very proud of. She said, I was in a bind and I made a Nearpod, emergency Nearpod in 10 minutes and just put it together. It was just like, I'm glad that you were so familiar with the tool that you were like, okay, these are the activities I need to do. And she was able to go ahead and kind of get the lesson out that quickly. And so part of it's like, once you're not learning the tool anymore, it's a lot faster because you're doing what you already know. Yeah.
When you're using different codes for different classes, can you go back at the end of the day and get the reports, or do you have to get them before you start the next code?
The reports are after they've done it. So, like...
So I can, if I've done the lesson 6 times,
yeah,
I can go back to that code and still... Mm-hmm. And that's saved forever?
Yeah, so in the reports menu, here, I'll show you what it looks like. So, this little house is where all your business is. So this reports here. If I were to look at, this is what we're doing today, and we're not even done, but you can see that we're in there now. So if I were to, this is us, we started, opened it at 8 a.m. I can actually, if you're doing a live session, this is how you know what class this is, except for the names, you could probably look at that too. But like, what time did it start? I know third period starts at 10:40, so I can kind of guess ballpark when that was. But I can also, once I see it here, rename it.
And those here are all the people that have looked at that specific location.
Yeah.
So yours would look like you'd have all these like 5 timestamps, and then
yeah,
you could just go through and rename them like period 1, period 2, period 3.
And we're not even done yet, but I already have data here that I can find. And so when you go to the reports, you can either just look at the overview here, which, you know, it's a pretty report, and you would just, each activity, if all of the quizzes would be listed here, all of the polls would be listed here, open-ended, draw it. And with my draws, I like that report too, because it gives me a little thumbnail of everybody's drawing there. So, I'm sorry. If I click downloads, this is where I can get a PDF of the session view, and that's like the list that you saw earlier with the math lesson that I showed you that had everybody in the class, everybody in the session. Or if I wanted to do a student view, it'll give me a report of just your stuff with how you answer each question, just you. So
just for that one session?
Yeah.
And for that one.
It'll give you like a folder.
Set up classroom, so you can look at one student and all of their sessions that they've ever logged in.
That's tougher because that's tougher, but you probably have to do that manually, as far as I understand right now. But as they're getting closer to having like the single sign on, that would be a little easier to search because the kid typed their name the same way every time.
Is there a way to share your Nearpod so you've made one?
Yes, absolutely. There is.
So you can take your fifth grade one and share it to your fifth grade teacher.
So what you can do with that. So that, are we okay on reports? Does that make sense, how to get in there and play with it?
Yeah.
Okay. And part of it's just to kind of just see what you need, what kind of information you need right now. You know, it's, but that's where you find it, is in the reports menu. So if I wanted to share with my team, because this is the other goal of the workshop, is I wanted teams to come so that, you know, you make lesson 1, I make lesson 2, she makes lesson 3. And we all get all of the work done by all of
them. So he's doing that this year as part of that?
Yes. Yes. So if I have this lesson here, this is how I share with a colleague. This is my library. These 3 dots right here give you an option to share. And so I have editable copies. So if I share with you this presentation and you want to make edits to it, it doesn't affect my original copy. It's your own copy that you're sharing. So it'll be your own reports. It'll, you know, it'll just show up there. It'll
That's
be your
neat.
Own copy. Yep. But it's exactly what I just did, so you don't have to make it. That kind of thing.
And are people selling them? Like, I'm teaching, if you teach
so there is
science thing, can you buy a Nearpod presentation?
So they have a program called the Nearpod Authors, and they will pay you for creating those, and then you get a cut after the advances spent on that.
Yeah.
But it says, so it's Nearpod Authors, so nearpod.com/authors. And that is a way you could get a free account too, a free premium account too, if you're participating in that program. But they're pretty tight about copyright with that kind of thing too, so you have to be careful, it's your own stuff. And if it's like, one of the reasons I like Haiku Deck is it puts attribution on the bottom of the picture so that you're not violating copyright by using it. They're all free, what is that word?
Creative Commons.
Yes, Creative Commons.
Oh, yeah,
Creative Commons. So, and Creative Commons sometimes has terms on it too. So, I mean, they tell you if there was something you need to change, because you're selling it, that's why. But that's how you would share with colleagues here. You can also, so we talk about Nearpod homework. When you have a link to a Nearpod homework, it expires 30 days from the last time somebody opened that session. Last time somebody clicked on it or went into it. So you've got, it renews. So on day 29, you have a kid go into it, it's got another 30 days to be live. Otherwise, it will show up invalid pin because it expired. If you want it to be just a slideshow that they don't turn in their work, where you just need to have it embedded in your website so you have that presentation there, you can choose to share it with a pin that doesn't expire. It's just you don't get a report of what they're doing. So if that's not important to you for that particular assignment, you would, instead of choosing student paste, you would go to the three dots, click share, and then use this link, which has a crazy pin, you know, that they would put in, or you can just embed it straight on a website. So what I have done for this presentation today is on my website, I have added, I changed it, but anyway, I'm gonna fix this, but this presentation will be embedded here because I edited it in the time between I embedded it here. You can embed it right on the website there and have it there. So if you wanted something where you didn't need any feedback, but you wanted just to have the presentation available, you just go in the share menu with the three dots instead of choosing student paste. But there's no report. Does that make sense? Which I was happy they actually had an option to do that. So I'm going to fix that on that page and share that with you guys. But okay. Let's talk really quickly about embedding. I like to use Weebly. It's very easy to use. It's not the only game in town, but this is what embedding looks like. So you choose your student-led session, choose this little embed code option, and we're watching a video on your screen right now. Copy that. You don't have to know any web code, and then you would just drag the element, which is embedding, embed code here, underneath, and then paste in that embed code that you just copied there, and then it just shows up embedded on the page. So embed code anywhere that would need that, it's awesome. So, because I like to keep people in the sandbox, you know, without having to go to other places as much as possible.
W-E-E-B-L-Y.
You can make a free website there with Weebly. And there are other websites, and the process is very simple. Yes, and I'm going to show you how to do that right now. Okay, so an LMS is a learning management system. And so we have the Canvas LTI, which I'm going to show you right here. And that's Panda Bear, because that's what they use. I think they're still using the Panda Bear. So here's how the Canvas LTI works. In our district, here in Canyons, it's on... Everybody's available. So you just go into your module, you choose external tool, and then find Nearpod in the list there, and then choose that. Then it would ask you to sign into your Nearpod account, and then you would just choose your Nearpod presentation you want to use. And then you click add item, and then it's in there. I'll show you what bottom of your module. If you are using Canvas, I suggest you make a course called Trying Stuff, because that's where you play. But you can see now that the Nearpod presentation is just embedded in the full page there. So If you're a Canvas user, we have about 30 minutes left. I think it would be smart for you to kind of, I want you to be able to go in and try to add a
I use my projector remote, and I probably wore it out. Because the way I would present, so this is my library. It's not as cute and nice. It's pretty deep into school when they brought the folders out. But I mean, you can see all of these things up here on the board. I didn't create a lot of these things. So for me, I used a lot of the library and finding other things people made. Because I found that a lot of the times it was exactly what I needed. Like this author's purpose, even though it's a 2 through 6, it was a little young, but what fifth grader doesn't need a good review on what author's purpose is at a basic level, you know? And so for me, I just use those a lot. But as I was going through, so let's say this is one of the ones I made for Reading Street is something we used in elementary all the time. But this is one that I made for that. And as I was going through, that will pop up. As I was going through, I would keep the slide projected. So the whole time Katie was talking, I would have had the slides up on my board. So that no matter where the kids were at, even if they weren't looking at their screen, if they wanted to look at the board, they could. And so I would use that to, I'd be going through and I'd say, okay, this week we're gonna, unit 5, week 2, here's this. And I would freeze it, we could talk about it. And I would have this up while they were logging in. And so I would use that a lot to just freeze it and go through it. And then when we get to those, I'd have my question of the week. And if the next question, so then here's a good example. So here's my concept talk video. I would freeze this so that it, on their screen, it kept this up there. But then I would have another tab that I would have open to like Pearson. And I would just go to my next tab, play the video, and then go. And you could embed it too, but I just found that it was easier with that specifically. Then I would just go back to my Nearpod, and I just go through. And then so, like if I was doing a vocabulary thing, so I've got the picture from the book, I would freeze this, and I think, yep, so the next one's a question. And you can see I have, just like Katie said, I have the little tile up there that they can look at on their screen, but up on my screen, I would freeze my projector, keep that up there, and then, so that's frozen up there, pretend that's because I can't find the remote, that's frozen. Now I go and I scroll to the next one so everyone's computer goes to the question, and so that's kind of how I manipulated it, so that no matter anywhere people were looking, it was still up on the board. And I found that with Nearpod, it really helped with my pacing because, I know even with secondary, you only have so much time. I mean, with elementary, I could kind of go a little bit more if I needed 20 more minutes or whatever. But you don't have that. So it really helped with my pacing and keeping me on track. Jenna, were you going to?
This was kind of random, but just a thought. For C-tests, Nearpod is like the most amazing way.
Yep.
You have like a direct instruction day and you go, oh crap, I know somebody's going to high pop me today. See, this is amazing.
So, exactly to that. I always got super excited when I knew that my principal was coming in and I had a Nearpod created because I would get everything in. I'd get the objective, I'd get the ICANN statement, I would have OTRs up the wazoo. And so for that, I was able to just go through, we talk about it. And for Reading Street, this is elementary, but we would have, it's scripted, it's there for you. So for me, I was just, these aren't questions I made up, these are questions I got out of my teacher manual. So it's not stuff that I had to be thinking of, and so as I was going through, I could go through just like what Katie did with hers, and now I'm right back in, now I'm into my next present, like my next strategy, which was graphic sources and inferring. So here's what we're talking about. Here's my ICANN statement. There's my objective up on the board. I made this in Haiku Deck. It was really easy. You just type it in, export it. So it was just a quick way to like keep my pacing. All my kids, I would have them say, okay, let's say, I'll say our ICANN statement, and they would all say it exactly right. If
they couldn't see the board, they could see their screen. So we go through, I took a screenshot of the book, here it is from the book. So it really helped me take it from not just opening a textbook, but onto your screen. And even though it's the exact same information, it's cool because it's on a computer screen now. You know, it's kind of that difference of mentality. Here it is again, inferring, my objective. This was a good one, I'm glad I opened this one. my I can statement, here's my comprehension strategy, and then then it goes right into a story that you're gonna use both of those concepts with. So here's we talked about Compass Rose, we talked about the map, we talked about the Titanic. Here it is right here, and for this specific one, I wanted it to be, we just read it a paragraph at a time. This is all on their screen going through. And so now I'm right into my vocabulary. So it really helps with my pacing. So again, I'd have my words, I'd have a picture with a sentence. And normally, again, what I would do is I'd go back to the vocab word, I'd freeze my projector, and here's my question. So on their screens and on my teacher's screen, this is what I see, but on as far as what's frozen on the projector, it would have been the vocab word with the definition.
And you can also put that vocab word picture here, too. So like, and that's what I love doing is having the reference slide in my question as well.
Mm-hmm.
Would be another way that you could do it there, too.
Yeah, and so just like on that one that I showed you with the scuba divers, I had that tile there ready to go. You know, and you can put anything in here, a 7-up question, you know, describe a place you've been, you know, blah, blah, blah. So, again, it helps with that. But if I was being IHOPs during this lesson, it would have been huge numbers for me. And so, that's why I love Nearpod is because, and so you can see up on the top, I have 63 slides in this Nearpod. So, I'm not going to get through 63 slides in my hour and a half or whatever it is for language arts. So what I would do is I would just keep this one for the whole week and then go into it the next day. Or sometimes I would make a copy and just take out what I've already used, make a whole new presentation if I wanted like a different code. So that's why I love it, is because it's just, and I was having a hard time staying on track with my, like staying in my hour frame of language arts or whatever it was. Because it just like you get scattered, you know, and your group discussions would go longer or whatever. So this really helped me stay on pace, get everything I need for C tests, and know that I was doing quality instruction, but making it interactive as well. So yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
Yep.
I'm gonna unplug you.
Yep. Go ahead.
All right. So one thing I want you to leave with today is just knowing that this presentation and a couple of other things are available to you using the Weebly. I wrote the shortened URL on the board there, and it is bit.ly/nearpodopenutah16, and that'll take you to this website, the web page where I put this presentation embedded in there.